We are going to start one of our more significant talks in the meeting. As most of you know, that 49 years back, American Pancreatic Association was co-founded by three eminent leaders. It was Frank Brook, Paul Webster, and Mel Gough. So we have a Frank Brook lecture in basic pancreatology, which we will have tomorrow. We have Mel Gough Lifetime Achievement Awards, which we will honor that during our dinner tonight. But right now, it's my distinct privilege and a pleasure to welcome Dr. Nageshwar Reddy for our Paul Webster lecture. Dr. Reddy got all his education, his medical school, his fellowship, his medical training, DM, in India. He's actually one of the few people I know that who have risen to where they are without having any training outside India. It's really an honor for those of you who know Indian system that is really. Pretty soon after getting his DM from Chandigarh, India, he worked in a medical school and then started what's known as Asian Institute of Gastroenterology. It started a little small. It's a tertiary care hospital for GI diseases. And it started relatively smart, just like, 400 beds hospital, just for GI. And I'm intentionally saying it's small, because last time I was there, I think on January 1st this year, he has expanded that now to, 900? I think Nagi will tell you. I think it's about 900, if I'm not mistaken. But who's counting? So Srivi is amazing how he has expanded. It's one of the best hospitals in India, for GI diseases at least, is Asian Institute of Gastroenterology. And he's the founder and chairman of that organization. One would think that if you are head of a hospital with 900 beds, that you will have no time for anything else. I mean, it's true for in US, when you are a CEO of a hospital with 900 beds or 400 beds, all time you spend is administration. In Nagi's case, and I can vouch there because I had the privilege of visiting him several times in the last 10 years or more. He still is probably one of the most active therapeutic endoscopists. He still probably does more ERCPs every week than anyone else. Well, when I say every week, his week is about 2.5 days, because 3.5 days he's out of country. So he, for example, he came last night at 8:30 p.m. And it's really for the honor to have him. I know how difficult. And tomorrow morning, he's going to do some ERCPs in Germany. So you can see what his schedule is like there. But even with that, Nagi has published 500 peer-reviewed papers. And not all of them are in clinical area. Actually, many of them, lots of them are in fundamental basic research, animal research, cell research. When you go to AGA or endoscopic meetings or others, when Dr. Reddy gives a talk, and I wanted to go one, there was no place even outside the room to stand and listen. And that's for his clinical talks, which always are popular. But I went to one of his basic science talks in AGA, and it was similar kind of a situation. Of course, he has gotten you know, he has served on many, many editorial boards, currently does that. If you publish 500 papers, I guess that's one way to do it. So you have to be on the editorial boards of many different things. He has gotten almost every award one can think of it. Master endoscopist from World Organization and the organizations I don't go to, ASGE, gastroenterology, every honor one can have from professional societies all over the world he has. I'm from India, and I know Indian system a little bit, although I've been out for almost 50 years now. But one of the most significant award which the President of India gives, and it really is physically given by the President and is nominated, is what, when I was young, we used to think, very enamored that someone got Padma Shri. Padma Shri is, you know, some, and he did. He got that in 2002. But then after that, there's one step higher, which is the most honored award any civilian in India can get, and that's known as Padma Bhushan. Nagi got that in 2014, I think. So he is one of the most accomplished scientists I know, gastroenterologist I know. But I think, to me, more important is that his humanistic society. He take care of his patients, he take care of people, he take care of his friends. And that's where I am. It's a privilege to call you a friend, sir, and honor to have you give a talk.
Thank you, Ashok, for that very kind introduction. I'd like to thank APA and, of course, Dr. Saluja in particular for the honor of giving me this invitation to talk at this Paul Webster lecture. I was told never to start a talk with an apology, but I make an exception here. The reason, in this very scientific, evidence-based conference, I'm going to give a talk on history, not on science. I'm going to talk on the history of evolution of pancreatic or biliary endoscopy. And the reason I think this is important is because if you look at how this major modality of treatment now for pancreatic or biliary disease is, it evolved through a phase which teaches us what we can do in future, how we can improve treating our patients with pancreatic or biliary disease in future. And that's the reason why I selected this. I started doing ERCPs in 1980, so being in the driver's seat, I can give you a bird's eye view or so-called 30,000 feet view of what's happening in this area. The first ERCP was done in 1968 by McCune. McCune was actually a surgeon in Washington, and he started ERCP with a very crude scope. In fact, it took him, the first ERCP he did, he could cannulate only the pancreatic duct, and it took him 6 hours. The subsequent three ERCPs took 4 hours each, and after the fourth ERCP, he gave it up because he's a surgeon, busy with surgical practice, and didn't want to go further. The actual beginnings of ERCP were in Japan in 1970, where Hitaru Oi, who was actually a student in a Japanese medical school, who started doing ERCPs. He actually convinced the manufacturers of an endoscopy company to create this side-viewing endoscope and consistently started cannulating the papilla. Of course, it helped that he married the daughter of the endoscopy manufacturer. And subsequently, he demonstrated that you could actually consistently cannulate the papilla, get the pancreatic and bile duct, and demonstrated this in 1970 in Copenhagen at the World Congress of Gastroenterology. This was very soon picked up by the gastroenterologists in Europe, and ERCP started from Japan to there. In fact, the term ERCP was actually coined by Peter Cotton, the first terminology. And the first publication on ERCP was in the Lancet in 1972. And you can see the title of this was Cannulation of the Papilla Vata. This won't even get you into a local newspaper if you want to publish now. So that was the first paper on ERCP. The first therapeutic revolution in ERCP occurred in 1973 when Classen in Germany and Kawai in Japan together published the technique of endoscopic spintrotomy and removal of common bile duct stones. In fact, Classen's was in German and Kawai was in GI endoscopy. In fact, there are several stories of this first spintrotomy in 1973, because if you realize at that time, it was a very adventurous thing to do because most of the CBD stones were removed by surgery. In fact, Kawai never did a ERCP in his life. The actual procedure was done by Nakajima, who was his assistant, and in Japan, because of the hierarchy, Kawai's name came first. Nakajima was the one who actually did the world's first ERCP and spintrotomy, and actually died recently quite bitter about it that nobody recognized him. Classen and Demling, when they did the first ERCP, the room was locked, so nobody knew who actually did it. It was just Classen and Demling. In fact, I recently asked Classen, and he told me he actually did it. So at least in Germany, there was no hierarchy, so his name was first, so everybody said Classen. So Kawai and Classen were the first. The interesting thing about both these first spintrotomies were that they were in medical people, because naturally a patient, when told the first procedure in the world, wouldn't accept it. So the first patient of Classen and Demling was actually a nurse working in their unit who had a CBD stone. And you can see this is a slide I borrowed from him. 7 years after the spintrotomy, the papilla is still open, and he wanted to demonstrate this to the surgeons. The first spintrotomy in Japan from Nakajima was actually in a medical student, third year medical student, who was going around with a CBD stone, and they managed to convince him and do the procedure. As in every aspect of ERCP, as soon as they did this, the first thing they did was to go into live demonstration. So 1973 was the first live demonstration in New York, where you can see the greats of ERCP, Cotton, Classen, Oe coming together to demonstrate ERCP to an audience in the New York Society of Gastroenterology. The first biliary stenting, palliative biliary stenting for obstructive jaundice was done by Nip Sohendra in 1979. And again, at that time, surgery used to be the usual technique of palliating this obstructive malignant jaundice, but Nip showed that you could do it endoscopically, and since then, several randomized controlled trials comparing surgery with endoscopy have shown that endoscopy is superior to surgery in terms of morbidity, mortality, and so on. So in 1970s, these were the pioneers of ERCP and pancreatic oblate endoscopy. In fact, they were not only pioneers in innovation, but they're very courageous, because at that time doing endoscopic pancreatic biliary therapeutic procedure was really considered very dangerous. In fact, Claude Ligeri was very famous, did the first spintrotomy in France and 1974, one of the first in Europe. Immediately after he did the first spintrotomy, he was actually sent away from his hospital, had to resign, because the surgical team felt he was doing something crazy, some dangerous things. And therefore, so you had to be a little crazy, think out of the box to do all these procedures in 1970s. And what is very paradoxical is that if you actually, then following this, the development of ERCP, of course, we know occurred initial diagnostic followed by therapeutic. And again, you'll see that in ERCP, concerns about quality and randomized control trials came very late. I'll come to that a little later, but if you actually look at the endoscopic literature, there's something paradox about this. Most of the innovations in ERCP occurred in 1970s, and the literature was only in form of case reports. As the literature became more strong, as we started getting randomized controlled trials, the innovations came down. In fact, the first randomized controlled trial in medicine was 48, in gastroenterology, Sidney Truelove's was in 55. The first RCT in actually endoscopy ERCP was in 1988, so very late. And once this came, for some reason the innovation started coming down, and I'll show you why. The reason is, of course, if you look at this, this was NIH conference in 2002, I think Marty must have been a part of that. This was a very rare NIH conference where they called endoscopists together. Generally, endoscopists are not considered very intellectual for NIH to get them together, but this was one of those rare conferences where they got them together. And they looked at the ERCP literature the last 22 years at that time to see what was the science in this literature. And you'll see what they found was that 22 years, only 19%, only 150 articles were suitable for inclusion in review of evidence, showing that the science of ERCP was lagging behind the clinical application of ERCP, which already was very common care standard of care in many hospitals. Of course, there are many reasons for this. In fact, if you look at this, in patients with acute biliary pancreatitis, the concept was that if we can do an ERCP very early and remove these CBD stones, maybe you can stop the progress of pancreatic necrosis and decrease morbidity and mortality. Many first study was positive, many studies came later, but they started contradicting each other. In fact, the first two were positive, then negative, and finally the consensus was maybe ERCP is not helpful in acute cases unless there's cholangitis. Now, why was this contradiction? And this is a contradiction in all pancreatic or biliary endoscopic therapies. The contradiction is because it's very difficult to get uniform operator availability in these cases. Endoscopic expertise vary, is timing of ERCP varies, exclusion varies, and the heterogeneous groups of drugs. And this is the problem with all endoscopic randomized controlled trials. And this is the reason why that getting good quality evidence is going to be difficult and getting good literature is going to be difficult in this field compared to other areas. So ERCP is now actually progresses in a 10-year interval. 1970, the first ERCP, then plastic stents, then SEMS, and then of course came the covered SEMS, and then the cholangioscopy. So it progressed in a very slow way. But we now have better accessories, we have better ability to cannulate the pancreatic duct lower. All this has made ERCP safer with lower complication rates, and this is now much easier. In fact, we have progressed to a large extent in this area. You can see that very difficult CBD stones which used to go for surgery no longer have to go. We do these partial sphincterotomies followed by a balloon sphincteroplasty, and then we can remove very large stones. Right now in most units who have expertise with ERCP, very few patients with stones in the common bile duct would go for any form of surgery. Similarly, in patients having chronic pancreatitis, pancreatic stones which are traditionally treated surgically can now be treated endoscopically with a combination of extracorporeal shock with lithotripsy and removal of the stones, technique that first came from Belgium. In fact, we have now shown that in over 5,000 patients with chronic pancreatitis with pancreatic stones, you can treat them very safely with this combination if they have a suitable anatomy. And of course, over a long period of 10-year follow-up, we've shown that the recurrence rates are as good or less than surgery. The first metal stent for CBD actually was put by Dr. Fimberger, in fact, in Germany, and the type of stent he used was very crude. You can see this here. This was a very dangerous looking stent that he actually used. In fact, one of the cases, the bile duct got caught into the stent and had to undergo surgery. But since then, there's been a dramatic improvement in metal technology, in science in this area, and we have now a variety of stents. In fact, we have a huge number of metal stents, and this has changed our practice paradigm. For example, we were told that if you have a patient with malignant obstructive jaundice in last stages, then you put a plastic stent. But if he has a life of more than 3 months, then you use a metal stent. This has changed now, this teaching has changed. This was a Dutch study, a multi-center study, which showed that irrespective of whatever stage the patient is in advanced malignant obstruction, it's always economically and also, of course, scientifically better to put a metal stent rather than a plastic stent. So plastic stents were out. And similarly, we have shown that in patients with benign biliary obstruction, whatever the cause, instead of putting multiple plastic stents, which is a standard of practice, we put in this completely covered self-expanding stents, take them out after 12 weeks, and this is probably better than doing multiple ERCPs and plastic stents. So therefore, what we have seen over the last 30 years is the death of plastic stents and the dawn of a new era with metal stents that are coming in, and there, of course, technology is improving dramatically. In patients with hilar tumors, for example, you're starting to take help from other areas, and this is what we called an MRCP targeted stenting. I think a concept that Marty actually advocated a lot in the beginning, but has now become the standard again. We never do an ERCP in a patient with hilar strictures without having an MRCP guide for us to know where the stents are put. In fact, I remember distinctly in a very famous workshop in Hong Kong, this was very, very long back before this concept came, me and Marty were together, and the patient of a hilar stricture was put up. There were 1,000 audience waiting to watch Marty Freeman do his famous stenting, but he refused. He said, there's no MRCP, I can't do this case. So this is, I think, their practice in change in Hong Kong now. They always do a MRCP before doing. We also taken, what's happening in hepatology with hepatomas, using radio frequency ablation to try and ablate this, and we actually now using this to ablate cholangiocarcinomas before putting in stents. And this year, we have had this randomized controlled trial from China, which clearly showed that using RFA in cholangiocarcinomas as a palliation increases survival and increases stent patency, and therefore this is becoming a standard of practice in many units. Now, what has happened over the last 30 years in terms of ERCP is that diagnostic ERCP has dramatically dropped. You can see the numbers. Whereas therapeutic ERCP has increased, maintaining the numbers. So I think finally, as we started this millennium, ERCP, diagnostic ERCP, as we know it, is no longer advocated. And there are two reasons for this. The first reason is that we have better non-diagnostic or semi-diagnostic techniques to diagnose conditions like MRCP and US, which always precede ERCP in most cases. But more importantly, I think this landmark paper, which actually changed our concepts of ERCP, paper 96, where Marty showed very clearly from both community and academic practices that ERCP has significant complications. Till then, for some reason, endoscopists didn't focus so much on complications of ERCP and didn't try to rationally look at these cases. But this paper opened our eyes and also showed us that the number of complications, of which pancreatitis is the most dangerous that can occur, and of course the most common, and this can result in several problems like this. This is the world's costliest painting. And when pancreatitis occurs, of course it becomes extremely costly, and everybody, the patient, relatives, doctor, everybody is screaming. We also know again from Marty's work which patients are likely to develop this post-ERCP pancreatitis. They're patient-related factors. There are also operator-related factors which can give rise to pancreatitis, and we know now how to avoid pancreatitis. And one of the major advances that have occurred, in my opinion, over the last 30 years in this field is avoidance of post-ERCP pancreatitis using pancreatic stents, rectal indomethacin, hydration. We have now able to decrease the pancreatic rates, at least in our unit, from 9% to 2%. And I think this is a significant advance that has made in this field, making it safer for the patient. We also can deal with other complications. This is an example of a CBD stone that's being removed from a patient with cirrhosis in our unit. And you see what happens. We removed the stone, but as we dragged the balloon down, we ruptured a varices in the common bile duct. So this is we tried to inflate the balloon, but we won't stop. And in a few minutes' time, the patient would die because of the bleed, unless something is done. Traditionally, these patients would be rushed to the OR, often with bad results, or interventional radiologists called in. But we now have better techniques. And what we did was to immediately put in a completely covered self-expanding metal stent, and dramatically the bleed stops. Again, advances in this area for patient safety. And the most important thing that we have learned now is that ERCP is the most dangerous for those who require it least. Of course, no diagnostic ERCP, and I think we should only do it only when it's strongly indicated. Apologies to Nike, of course. The other area where there's been a progress and where we changed our tracks in ERCP is the advance of single-operator cholangioscope. Normally in ERCP, as endoscopists, we inject contrast into the bile duct and common bile and the pancreatic duct. It used to be a radiological procedure, but now, using these cholangiopancreaticoscopes, we can go into the bile duct, into the pancreatic duct, and actually visualize what's happening inside. And let me show you a dramatic example. These are two patients, exactly similar picture on ERCP, obstruction in the mid part. All of the investigations were negative. They were supposed to have cholangiocarcinoma to go for surgery. But when we did the cholangioscopy, you can see very clearly this patient, you can see swelling coming up here, a mass from which biopsies were taken. And in this patient, something more dramatic. You can see a swelling, but you can see caseous material coming out. Of course, we took biopsies from both these cases, and you can see this turned out to be a B-cell lymphoma, and this was tuberculosis. Both cured by medical treatment without surgical interventions. So this is just an example of how cholangiopancreaticoscopy is altering our approach to these patients. And finally, when you come to patients, when you're doing ERCP, of course, you have to have access to the papilla, to cannulate the papilla, see the bile duct. But in some cases, you don't have an access. And these are the patients who have gastric outlet obstruction, who have post-operative situations, and so on. So when we can't get to the papilla, what we would do is to get to our interventional radiologist, who would do a percutaneous procedure, and of course, and then go forward. But this has changed a little with the advent of endoscopic ultrasound. In fact, endoscopic ultrasound has gone the same way as ERCP, from a diagnostic procedure done with a radial scope to a therapeutic procedure with little diagnosis to a linear scope. We now use these linear scopes and you can actually access the bile duct, the pancreatic duct very easily. And in most units now, we have stepped away from interventional radiologists to an endoscopic ultrasound. The first endoscopic ultrasound therapeutic procedure to tame the bile duct was done by Marc Giovannini in France. In fact, he was doing an ERCP, was frustrated because he couldn't get into the bile duct and quickly changed to an EUS scope, could get in very easily into this dilated bile duct to put a stent. But I think the first large series of rendezvous procedure where an ERCP was not possible and where a guide wire could be put into the papilla and then ERCP continued was again Marty's group who demonstrated this, that this is a technique that's possible combining EUS with ERCP. Of course, we now drain these bile ducts very commonly, either using the gastric route, the transgastric approach, or the duodenal route. In both ways, we can put stents just like we do in ERCP. And in fact, in most units where pancreatic or biliary endoscopy is being done quite routinely, we are now switched to doing endoscopic ultrasound-guided biliary drainage if ERCP fails. I think this is sort of a consensus opinion now, and there are many trials now, randomized control, trying to compare percutaneous with this. But what is more paradigm changing and what is more interesting is a suggestion that instead of doing ERCP at all, why not we start everything with endoscopic ultrasound, stop ERCP because radiology, radiation and so on. So this is an approach that some units are advocating for primary biliary drainage. And there have been two papers this year, one from the Orlando group, where patients were randomized into two groups, those who had ERCP and those who had endoscopic ultrasound primary drainage, and showed that EUS drainage was better. And similarly, a Korean study, again, which showed that endoscopic ultrasound primary drainage is better. And there's some units in the United States where they're doing EUS-guided CBD stone removal also to avoid. So are we going to change? Are we going to stop ERCP? I personally feel that the answer is still no, because many of these EUS units which are doing endoscopic ultrasound, the expertise is very high. The complication rates therefore are low. But in an average hand, endoscopic ultrasound guided complications are much higher than ERCP in these type of processes. And therefore, it's still not prime time. I still have to wait, but we may get to that stage later on. The first EUS guided pancreaticography was done in Belgium by Pierre Dates unit, and then you can see that they drain the pancreatic duct. You can actually, like what Marty showed earlier, if you have a remnant pancreatic duct, you don't have access to the papilla, you can always do stenting through endoscopic ultrasound guided approach, and this is becoming more and more common now. And of course, the evolution of treatment of peripancreatic fluid collection has been dealt with very extensively in the last symposium. We have gone from direct pancreatic necrosectomies to, of course, putting in these specialized stents and doing endoscopic pancreatic necrosectomy only when it's necessary. This evolution, I think, has shown how you can safely go through from a risky procedure to a safe one to benefit the patients. And also now, another interesting concept is to use radiofrequency ablation in patients with pancreatic cancer, a part of the palliation therapy. And we reported a series of cases recently along with the Korean group, where you can see large tumors where they are having a lot of pain, not relieved by conventional techniques. After RFA, you can see the tumor is completely necrosed with relief of pain and maybe enhancing the chemotherapy effect. But I think the most important area where EUS RFA is going to make a difference is in pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors. We have recently published a series where in patients with insulinomas, which were very symptomatic, surgery could not be done. Endoscopic ultrasound guidance, RFA, actually resolved the process. And we have a 5-year follow-up of these patients now, showing that there's no need for surgery. Recently, a French group has published a series of 30 neuroendocrine tumors, pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, treated predominantly by US RFA. So I think this is another very important area where we're evolving. In patients with pancreatic masses, sometimes difficult to differentiate benign from malignant, US confocal microscopy may have a resolution, and this is another area which is rapidly coming in. Of course, we are also reaching the gallbladder with the use, but I think an important area that I'd like to focus is that with all these advances, it becomes very important to have optimum training. There are many centers in the United States which have 1-year pancreatic or biliary training programs now, and I think this actually should be expanded to 2 years, because it's not a very easy thing to learn. You require some time to get mastery in this. Our traditional training has been not very effective. And I think when you say ERCP is ensuring really competent practice becomes important. You have to have both cognitive and technological technique training. Unless these are there, I don't think it will be effective. Unfortunately, the simulators that are available currently for training are not good enough for ERCP. And most of the animal models, again, are not adequate because the anatomy in the animal models is totally different from human beings, so it becomes difficult. We are now starting to, most of the ERCP training is done in like this sort of teaching sessions or in large workshops where you have a lot of people sitting and performance is done, but we're now starting to get these nice mechanical models which actually give the skills, and we have, this is the, called the Costa Magna model, which is now being used all over the world. To train ERCP gives you the dexterity, how it should be used, and so on. I think we require more of this to enhance our training. Let me just dwell a few minutes on the future based upon what has evolved. I think one of the problems we are starting to have as endoscopists now is that we're seeing more and more patients who have undergone surgery, especially bariatric surgery. So our approach to papilla now changes. We can't go in, so we have to use an enteroscopy, which is very inadequate. More and more lap-assisted ERCPs, and of course, US-guided gastroplexy. So you can create a fistula between the esophagus and the stomach, put a self-expanding metal stent, and then go in and do ERCP. So these are the areas where we have to concentrate to see how we can do better in terms of safety to our patients. The other area which I think is becoming more and more important is this so-called drug-resistant CRE infection. This was reported, of course, from some centers in the United States, caught attention of both the lay public and the endoscopy manufacturers. The problem with ERCP is the scope tip is very complex. It's difficult to clean, and it's not very, so even if you get, if you can't completely clean this, have infection in one patient, that's going to create a problem. So what is going to happen, in my opinion, is going to be these disposable endoscopes that are coming up. In fact, there's a German company, Invendo, which is already making upper GI and colonoscope. And there's another company in US which is making a disposable ERCP scope. The first trials of these scopes are starting from this month. And my belief is in 5 years' time, we'll be doing ERCP only with disposable scopes, not with standard scope, because I think that's going to become, these scopes are quite good and they can be, of course, I think, used very safely without infection. And soon we may come out with this combined ERCP US scope, because the field has now become so interlaced with each other that somebody doing ERCP has to do in the US and the scope can be commonly used. And finally, a little peep into the future, what's going to happen. These technologies are already available. Of course, this is one of my European friends watching the World Cup football match. And this always interests them. I mean, football in Europe is something extremely big. So what has happened is one of his patients, of course, has a severe abdominal pain, doesn't have to go to the hospital, takes a capsule. This is a capsule which is actually made by one of the companies now, which is very large, not enough to swallow, but it's going to become smaller, goes inside, and the capsule is an endoscopic ultrasound capsule which conveys the information to the gastroenterologist on a broadband to the television screen. And you can see that he's continuing to watch, and then you can see the nice bile duct and CBD stone says gallstone pancreatitis. So he doesn't have to rush to do this. And then of course, he also knows what to do because match is very important. He just opens another part of the capsule and a small robot comes out. These technologies are available with NASA already, not commercialized. And the robot goes to the papilla, opens up the papilla with a laser beam, goes into the bile duct, sees the common bile duct stone, which is responsible for the pancreatitis, and then using a unique technique, is able to get this stone out. So of course, as I said, this is something I may not see in my lifetime, but it will come sometime. But one of the things that I learned very early on, this is very important because he continues to watch the last goal which changed the match. So I think one of the things that's going to, this technology is going to change how we approach our patient. But in spite of all these technologies, I learned a very interesting lesson very early on in my ERCP course. And this is a very unique video that I'm going to show you. I was doing ERCP when I saw this ascariasis cannulating the bile duct. See, this is an ascariasis. This is the papilla. It doesn't cannulate immediately. It sort of palpates around the papilla, looks at the anatomy of the bile duct, is trying to go towards the direction of the bile duct, and then it cannulates the bile duct. The cannulation rate of ascariasis for the bile duct is 100%. The reason is 100% is that by mistake, if it goes into the pancreatic duct, it dies. So it's mastered this technique. So I tell my fellows sometimes, if you can't get the CBD, just tie a small ascaris tip of your sphincterotome. It'll always go into the bile duct. Unfortunately, for us, if you go into the pancreatic duct, the patient dies, not the endoscopist. If it was the reverse, our cannulation rates would probably be 100%. So I think this is the lesson I learned here was that when you approach the papilla, you have to be very gentle, look at the anatomy, palpate around, don't just jab directly into the bile duct, and then try and achieve a very high success rate of cannulation, and then it's safe for the patient. And finally, I think, as with all parts of endoscopy, in pancreatic or biliary endoscopy also, it's a team effort. It's groups of people now who are actually experts in different areas coming together, producing results which are safe for the patient and effective for the patient. We have a wonderful team. This is a new hospital which Ashok was talking about. We have a wonderful team who do all the work, and I take the credit. Thank you for your attention.
Amazing talk into the past, present, and future. I'm a little bit concerned about future, that because I was sitting next to Marty, and when he saw that video, he says, "What will happen to my job with this? What's happening?" And you know, which is really true. But really, it's an amazing talk and a very, very gracious talk, giving credit to everyone. And not to himself. Really amazing. So I don't think we have time for questions. This in this our state of art lectures, we don't have tradition of questions. I'm sure Dr. Reddy is going to be available at lunch and other places. Please ask anything or any questions. And Darwin Conwell, our president, has an award our speaker.
So Dr. Reddy, that was just an excellent presentation. We all enjoyed it very much. So I want to just present you this plaque or appreciation for the Paul Webster Third State of the Art Lecture. Thank you so much for what you've done.